I am Mars Geuze, the commercial director of Hard Hyperloop, one of the founders of Hard Hyperloop, before that also one of the founders of Delft Hyperloop. So how that started was we started as a student team competing in the competition of Elon Musk. We won that competition and then proceeded as a spin-off company. And since then we've raised several private funding rounds, and what we are doing as a company is developing the Hyperloop and bringing it to the market. When we started the company, the thing that really triggered me was what's actually the societal challenges that we're trying to overcome, and how can we fit the Hyperloop in those challenges. We see a lot of sustainability challenges there. Hyperloop is very important for the long distance, high speed travel, and I think we can make a big difference in that aspect. Hard Hyperloop started in 2017, early 2017. We were first invested by the Dutch Railways together with a regional fund. So what we try to do is really collaborate in a very broad industry and public sector to co-develop Hyperloop and see how it fits in the societal challenges. So the Hyperloop is a new mode of transportation for large volumes of passengers and cargo. It's faster than an airplane, but it has a lower energy usage than a train. And how it works is that you have a tube network with a very low pressure environment, and that makes it possible to travel with almost no energy usage, with a very low resistance. So that's why you can travel so fast. And with this product, we want to have a sustainable alternative to long-distance high-speed transportation. Our timeline is to work towards a full-scale, full-system facility somewhere at the start of the 2020s, and then prove all the technologies, prove operations, so that in the next decennium we can also start building the first pilot. The largest challenges for infrastructure in general is that you have to implement the infrastructure. It's a completely new infrastructure. We already have a road network, we have a rail network. The big benefit of flying is that you can place an airport and an airport and have these all over the world, and you can fly point to point. The difficulty for Hyperloop is that you need to build new infrastructure, and to get that off the ground, it needs to be very clear what are the benefits. You need very broad support, and then there's still a long timeline to get it all realized. So everybody knows that once the technology is ready, you still need some time to implement it. So therefore, it also takes more time to get everybody on board for developing the technology and putting it all together. The vision of HART is to be able to travel anywhere, anytime, that you don't have any boundaries anymore. You can live, work, and be wherever you want. So that's why we're trying to build a system that's very flexible, almost on demand. So what you can do is just no longer have to plan your trips months in advance. And you know, if you want to do it last minute, there's less options, less flexibility, higher prices, but that we can offer a system where on the fly, you can just go to wherever you want to go. It's always direct point-to-point connections. So for example, if we would have a line from Amsterdam to Vienna, there would also be stations in between, for example, Frankfurt, Munich, Eindhoven, but those would not be stops. So you can go into a vehicle that goes directly to Munich, to a vehicle that goes directly to Vienna. So you can make use of the top speed for the full length. You can merge in and out of traffic, much like a highway. And that allows it to have one infrastructure that makes it possible to have many different streams inside it. So that also allows it that you don't just have these long distance connections where we can travel freely for tourism, for example, but also for the shorter connections that you can completely redefine how we live and work. Suddenly places like 100, 200 kilometers away are just 15 minutes away. So you can commute also in much shorter distances. So if we can get a system like this off the ground, it would both redefine the way you live and work and the way we travel for leisure or for business. So the top speed of Hyperloop would be about 1,000 kilometers per hour. Ideally, we would be able to make straight lines as much as possible between the European capitals, and then you can have very short trip times. So it really depends on how can we build this network. If we can build straight lines as much as possible, we can be faster than an airplane. So it would be probably somewhere around an hour or so, Amsterdam, Vienna. But the difficulty is, how do we integrate it with the rest of the environment? So the first study we did, we found out that actually 70% of the route we can follow existing infrastructure. It would greatly decrease the costs. It would also mean that you have a slightly lower average speed. The average speed would then somewhere be around 550, 600 kilometers per hour. And then you have the same travel times as an airplane. But the big difference is that you can go city center to city center. So it's no longer leaving from a place you didn't want to leave from and going to a place you didn't want to go to, but you integrate it all into the trip. And we also believe that the boarding process can be much more like going into a metro instead of the whole process that you have to go for an airplane. So I think that's the really big kicker that makes it so competitive. If we look at the future of transportation, there's a few very interesting trends happening. If you look at cars and automobiles, buses and so on, there's first a trend of electrification, ride sharing, autonomous driving. And one of the things that's happening there is that you get more focus on the value of comfort rather than just the value of time. You don't have to drive yourself anymore. How can I use the time that I'm traveling usefully, either in a leisure or in a business way? That's a very important trend. And if you see the ride sharing, you can get more people in the same roads. You also see that long distance transportation is really growing and growing. Last year, there was a growth of more than 6% of the amount of kilometers traveled in aviation in Europe. And there's no sign of this trend slowing down. And there is the last trend that we see. It's also the sustainability question. So you see both growth, both in the shorter distances and in long distances. Now for the shorter distance, at least we're doing electrification and ride sharing, so that helps already with sustainability. But we don't really have a good alternative yet for sustainable long distance and high speed travel. There's a report recently that said that even if we would spend 200 billion euros every year in high speed rail, then still aviation by itself, and especially the tourism, would absorb the entire CO2 budget of the Paris Agreement. So there's something going on here where either we have to limit the amount of travel that we have, and that would really also impact the tourism industry, or we need to somehow come up with alternatives. And I think that's also where the Hyperloop then fits in. It's like this combination of, we see a lot of growth, but climatically it's not sustainable, so that's the crossroads where we are right now. Travel is extremely important. Sometimes you have people say if we can't travel sustainably, then maybe we have to stop traveling. But I really don't believe that that's going to be a solution. From the very first people moving out of Africa, you know, the we've always been an exploring species, and more and more we're becoming international. So people study abroad. I think 7% of all the people studying are people studying abroad, and it really broadens our horizons. So I think it's very important that we keep exploring and keep connecting with other cultures and learning from other cultures. So travel will always be a very important part of humanity. And as you can see, it's growing and growing. So I don't think this will ever stop. I think one of the most important ways in which Hyperloop will impact travel and tourism is both by offering a completely new mode, a new way of traveling. Very flexible, high frequency. You can go whenever you want for a very competitive price. So I think it will really stimulate people to travel for leisure on a more spontaneous basis. So you can just suddenly decide, okay, I'm going to Vienna and be there in an hour. So that's going to completely change the way we think about leisure traveling. But also, Hyperloop is needed for having the sustainable growth that we have right now. So it's not just something that adds to it. It's also something that's, if we don't have some sustainable alternative, then we will have to put the brake on leisure travel at some point, which I believe is really bad for humanity. So if we can provide an alternative to at least keep us moving, that's one of the things that Hyperloop could do. Well, if you look at the way we, so not just for tourism, but also in a daily, and daily, how we look at how we daily travel. You know, we all started in the working in the same city, and then came cars and trains, and now we don't just live in that one city, but we are
living in a radius of about 30 to 50 kilometers. And what Hyperloop could really bring is that you don't no longer have these boundaries. You can live and work wherever you want. So that means also that if you live somewhere and you see an opportunity far away, which you usually wouldn't take because you built your life around where you live right now, suddenly this also becomes within the realm of possibilities. So the possibilities for you as a person on where you can live and work and build a life and grow, that will completely change. Because of the high speed of Hyperloop, it's important to have reasonably straight lines. We always design the system with comfort of the passengers in mind. So we have the same comfort standards that are used in the train, and we have some technologies to make sure that you can bank in the corners, so you can go through a corner and still feel very comfortable, but you're still limited by a certain straightness of the infrastructure. And that makes it, of course, difficult to build this kind of infrastructure also in mountainous areas. So two of the most important things that we look at is, can we follow existing infrastructure for as much as possible? Because then you already have the lines. And two is, can we increase the efficiency of constructing this both above ground and underground? Corridors like Austria are very important in the larger European scheme. So if you look at Austria, it's an important corridor from Stuttgart, Munich, then Vienna, and then into Eastern Europe and more to Southern Europe. So there's an important corridor there where you will have a lot of passengers traveling, even if they don't just go to Vienna, go somewhere else in Austria. So it's also important to build these corridors in a larger, if you look at it from a larger perspective. So if you look at then what the cost would be for implementation, but also what you would get from it if you look in the larger picture, then the social and economic benefits that you get from it are well larger than the cost of building it. So yeah, you will get some complexities in mountainous areas, but that would not mean that you won't do it anymore. There's still the benefit of actually connecting within Austria, but it's also important to make the connection through Austria to the other places. So, in the end, that will even out. And you see much more and more that service providers in the transport industry are looking outside of their own modality. So even the airline in the Netherlands says that please use the train up to 500 kilometers and then we'll fly from there. And more you see this within the transport industry. And it's very important to not just look at the big lines, but also how do I get from my station to the final destination, so the last mile. And that's also the studies that we do. We always look at not just the point-to-point connection, but how do you integrate with all the local stakeholders and how do you work together, for example, with airlines or local rail operators or the metro or new services on how to provide a full package. So Hyperloop would never be you would never get stops that are closer than something like 50 kilometers or so. So you wouldn't have a whole network to get you to your house. But therefore, it's important to not just look at a Hyperloop station as a Hyperloop station, but more as an intermodal hub where you integrate with all the other modalities. Hyperloop is not a single solution for all the mobility problems that we have. There's a specific niche in which it's very strong, which is high speed, long distance. And it needs to integrate with all these new technologies that we're developing and the traditional infrastructure that we have to provide a full system solution. The largest risks that we are very aware of is the sustainability challenges. So what politically will be done to try to somehow limit the amount of kilometers that's being traveled, because there's not many other things that we can do to have sustainability in, for example, aviation. So how will these decisions also affect the tourism sector? I think that's a very important risk to be aware of. So right now, a lot of the aviation sector, for example, is not being taxed. But if at some point we will start doing that, what kind of effect will that have? And how can we prepare now for making sure that we don't get big negative effects from that? And therefore, looking widely into all kinds of different solutions, including self-driving cars, but also Hyperloop as a new mobility solution, to anticipate how can we use this in the scenario where we have to, you know, somehow tax the mobility. And we see Hyperloop really as a system that is that's for everyone. So it's not just the richest people who can use it. And the way we think that it's possible to finance that is by really combining all these different passenger streams into one infrastructure. So you won't just have leisure travelers, you won't just have the commuters, you won't just have business travelers, but you have them all in one infrastructure that makes it possible to get many different ticket streams and therefore make a good business case for the Hyperloop infrastructure in general, even if you have ticket prices that are very competitive with current regional rail travel or with aviation, for example.